in open surgery, 0.4% and above in, about 0.4-0.5% in laparoscopic surgery. The point is that these results are actually coming from, you know, centers of excellence.
Yes.
These are not community determined injuries, because if you look at the overall scenario in the community, the incidence may actually be much higher both for open as well as for laparoscopic. These are series from Johns Hopkins, from Mayo's Clinic, from VA hospitals, you know, they are these centers of excellence which are reporting these kind of injury rates. But in others, obviously it is going to be much higher. Fortunately, I think we have been lucky for many, many years, we have not yet seen one, but then great, that's one. Secondly, was the about the diagnosis of CBD stones on ultrasound. Well, it is true that these kind of stones should have been diagnosed, because they were, you know, a chain of very large stones in the CBD, so I think they should have been diagnosed. But it is also true that unlike gallstones, which are generally diagnosed correctly about 98-99% of the time on ultrasound, for the CBD, the pickup rate is only about 60%. And once again, 60-70% is the pickup rate in good centers, which report their results. CBD stones to pick up on ultrasound are not always very easy. In fact, I would still say that when they were picked up at Quadra, we must give them even more credit, because they were not only picked up, but they were picked up in a post-operative setting, which makes things much more difficult. Having said that, the fact remains that this was not one of those little stones loitering in the CBD. This was a chain of huge stones, which ideally should have been picked up. But just to set the record straight, CBD stones on USG overall are picked up only about 60-70% of the time. It is not as reliable an investigation as it is for gallstones. The only point that I found, these things can happen to anyone, so you know, it's a very unfortunate for the patient, for the surgeon, for everyone. But the real unfortunate thing that I found was this was operated in a fairly good nursing home with a fairly good surgeon. But the discharge certificate was, unfortunately, that is why I always tell the residents also, such a shabbily written discharge, one-line discharge certificate, and that's all. So, I mean, a kind of go-to-hell kind of a discharge certificate, you know. A complication can happen, but then, you know, you at least have to, you know.
Courage to own it up.
Not even courage to own it up, even if you want to hide, but at least write something on the discharge certificate, rather than just a half a line discharge and, you know, do whatever you want to types. So I think at least something must be written, some operative findings, even if you want to save your skin, it's absolutely okay, but at least write something, just a half a line discharge certificate, laparoscopic done, converted to open, drain revealing by, just go home, that's all. Patient has been discharged.
Is that the way to avoid medical legal complications?
Well, that's the way to get into it. That's the way to get into it, not avoid. You cannot avoid medical. Because finally in the medical legal, this thing only your papers are going to go. This is not the way to avoid, this is the way to get into it. So that is one thing, I think this is the real thing, that at least it should be a complication, can happen, but at least that should be properly documented in whatever way you think is best, but not this half-line discharge and go to hell attitude. Drain, of course, it was put there. Now, normally, you know, a lot of people put drains even routinely for all gallbladder surgeries, open and laparoscopy. We generally have not been putting drains routinely, maybe 1 in 200 cases, sometimes when we find some special requirement we do. We never put in drains, and we've generally not faced any problem with regard to that. Regarding Shomapika's question about why we did the laparoscopy first and then went in for laparotomy, well, the idea was actually different, and we didn't actually do a full laparotomy. We knew that there was a big collection in the abdomen of the patient, in the subhepatic and the suprahepatic spaces. 2 liters had already been aspirated. It was still there, patient was toxic. So what we wanted, we were obviously not going to do any definitive surgery in a toxic septic patient with huge collection. So we first had to make him stable, we had to drain his bile duct, and we had to drain his collection. That was our primary objective. Because if we would have operated on this patient, he would have either died on the table or maybe ended up with a restriction. So the idea was to drain the whole collection and then put in a stent through the endoscope. We wanted to actually, if possible, but there were so many adhesions and so many loculations, but the real advantage that we got from the laparoscopic, the diagnostic laparoscopy was, we managed to clean the abdomen, we washed the entire abdomen, and where we located this huge multiloculated segment of the bile collection, we just went in extra peritoneally and made an incision which was about 3 to 4 centimeters towards the back, not even towards the abdomen, because he had already undergone a major surgery once. He would require another one in the future. We didn't want to go in again for a third time. If required, we would have had to, but we were avoiding that, and we managed to avoid it. We just made a 3-centimeter incision towards his back where that whole collection was there. And laparoscopic, with laparoscopic guidance, we managed to avoid the gut and put in those drains there. And then sent him for ERCP stenting. So with that, this patient stabilized completely. You know, his sepsis was gone, his drain was okay, and with the stent in place, the collection also subsided. After, of course, I think a month or so, six weeks after that, when the patient was stable, then we went in for a colorectal with a high anastomosis. Because the other thing one must understand that it will never, these anastomoses are not very easy anastomoses. These are generally very difficult anastomoses for three reasons. One is because you are operating in a post-operative field. And that to a post-operative field which has been, you know, there have been infection, leakage, lot of adhesions, etc. So that is one thing. The field is not good. Number two, these are injuries which are generally high. It is not the same as doing a biliary bypass for a carcinoma head pancreas, where you have a big duct and right low down and anyone can do it. This is a very high anastomosis. And thirdly, and not only that, because a lot of these injuries are associated with vascular injuries also when they are doing it. And very often one of the common reasons why these injuries happen is because you injure the blood vessel, you panic, you decide to, because at that time you feel can be bleeding, to bandho patient bache baad mein dekha jayega jo ho. So then when you start catching the bleeders, you tend to catch the CBD along with it. But what happens as a result is that the vascularity of the CBD also, you know, reduces. So long-term strictures are very often. So what we do is I at least generally, even if the injury is a little low, we go into the left duct, and that is recommended. We go right into the left duct and do the anastomosis there from the ILO. Because at least that will take care of any, you know, vascular related or ischemia related stricture, anastomotic stricture. So these are the reasons why it is.
Palpation of the stools?
No, you know, see, the policy is that for any patient who comes with gallstones and has an abnormal, either he has jaundice or even if not obvious jaundice and abnormal LFT, it is then that we do an MRCP and then go ahead and proceed, either do an ERCP stone removal if it is possible, otherwise going for open surgery. Laparoscopic CBD stone removal is possible, maybe not for these kind of stones, single stone dilated duct, it is possible. So that is different, but to diagnose CBD stones on the table with the help of, you know, under laparoscopy is not possible. The only way in which you can do it possibly is if you have doubts, if you do an intraoperative laparoscopic cholangiogram. Complex, messy procedure, but that is the only way possible. You can, like in open surgery where you put your finger and try and palpate the CBD, no, that is not possible even in a routine cholecystectomy. But in these cases, of course, where there's so much of radiations in those areas, the question does not arise.
The LFT was done preoperatively initially.
Yes. See, that record we don't have. And in the initial pre-op, whether the LFT was done or not done, that record we do not have.
So
but it is also true that sometimes you can have stones in the CBD with a small 5 mm stone with a bilirubin of 20. And at the same time, you can have a chain of stones like this with a normal LFT. It is possible. It should be the other way around, but sometimes that does happen.
Yevgeny has mentioned one injury of E5, right at the, you know, that transected at the liver bed. How do you repair those kind of injuries?
No. See, basically, when you are doing E5, the right and left ducts are completely separated. So you will have to, in all the other cases, since the hilum is joined, we go into the left duct. The left duct has a more extrahepatic course. This is the right and left duct. The right duct goes straight into the liver, whereas the left duct first remains outside the liver for about 1.52 centimeters, then goes into the liver. So normally we go into the left duct and then look for the right duct. But when they are completely separate, then we have to locate them separately. It just makes things much more difficult. The procedure remains the same, but it makes things much more difficult because then the right duct cannot be access through the left duct if they are completely separated. So you have to look at the right duct separately, which is not easy. But you will know that on MRCP. The other thing, of course, which he was mentioning about ERCP and PTC, you know, when we were students, ERCP was not there actually. It had was just coming. Now, ERCP will, the role of ERCP is okay if there is a lateral injury, So you can stent it and try to, you know, avoid surgery. But the other thing is, it may, even if there is a complete transection, the problem with ERCP is it will show you the lower end because nothing will go above that.
Yes.
We are not interested in the lower part of the CPT because it is not going to help us in any way. We are interested only in the upper part with which we are going to anastomose, and that is why the PTC was very important. It's a little cumbersome thing nowadays. It is almost obsolete with the advent of MRCP. PTC and ERCP for diagnosis is almost obsolete. For diagnosis, the MRCP is by far the best. Occasionally, when you cannot do an MRCP for, you know, reasons, patient has metals and pacemakers or whatever, so an MRCP is not possible. There you may still have to resort to this ERCP or PTC combination, and more importantly the PTC. But that is also that technique, you know, that expertise is becoming increasingly rare because of MRCP it is hardly ever done. So you are looking at that scenario, biliary injury, where patient has a pacemaker or a metallic implant. So even that expertise is becoming increasingly rare. And apart from that, the MRCP is the gold standard now. It gives us beautiful pictures. We know exactly where we are. At least we know, you know, how much difficulty we can encounter. Even then it may be difficult sometimes, but that is how it is. So PTC and ERCP for diagnostic purposes, I think you'll agree, is meant only for those cases where MRCP is not possible.
Do you put a stent in after the anastomosis
or
is not required?
See, I mean, a lot of people put stents. My policy is generally we don't put stents. We don't put stents. I mean, people don't put stents and people do put stents. I would say 70% would put stents, 30% may not put stents. We as a routine policy do not put stents.
Very good.